Hey guys, in this video we'll talk about adrenergic antagonist. So there is already part 1 for this video. If you haven't watched, please do watch that video so that you'll have a clear idea what I'm talking in this video, right? So in the first part of my video I have discussed about alpha adrenoblockers. In this video I would like to talk about beta adrenoblockers. So we should understand where the receptors are located, what happens when those receptors are stimulated, what happens when those receptors are blocked. Right, so we are talking about beta receptors, beta adrenoreceptors. So beta adrenoreceptors are classified into three types, that is beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. Right, so we should know what is the location of these receptors and what happens when they are stimulated, what happens when they are blocked. So whenever, first thing we should know where beta 1 receptors are located. Beta 1 receptors are located in the heart. They are also located in the JG apparatus of the kidney. Right? Beta 2 are located in the bronchus. Beta 2 also located in the blood vessels. They are also located in the uterus. There is also location in the pancreas as well, but major important locations we need to remember is beta 2 locations is bronchus and blood vessel, right? Beta 3 are located in the adipose tissue. So what happens whenever I stimulate beta 1 receptors on the heart, what will happen? Contractility, conductivity of the heart will be increased, which means heart rate will be increased. So what effect is achieved? Sympathetic effect is achieved. So when we are talking about beta 2 adrenoreceptor, they are located in the bronchus. So whenever I stimulate the beta 2 adrenoreceptors, what should happen in the bronchus? Bronchus should dilate. So it is a sympathetic activity on the bronchus. In the blood vessel, vasodilation will happen. And in the uterus will, whenever I stimulate the beta 2 receptors of the uterus will relax. Right, beta 3 are located in the adipose tissue. We don't have to remember any drug which works with the beta 3 adrenoreceptor. We don't have any drugs which deals with that. Right, so now I explained what happens when they are stimulated, right? But we are talking about antagonist. Antagonist is nothing but it is a drug which blocks the receptor. So what happens when I block the beta 1 receptors, which is located mainly, we are talking about heart here. So the contractility and conductivity of the heart is decreased, right? What about beta 2 adrenoreceptor? When they are blocked, bronchus will start to contract. What about blood vessel? Blood vessel will also start to contract, because whenever I stimulate beta 2 receptors on the blood vessel, it is causing vasodilation, right? So uterus also same thing. If I block the receptor, it will start to contract. If I stimulate the receptor, it will start to relax, right? So we'll start to discuss about the drugs. So we don't have any drugs to remember with the beta 3, so I'm removing it, right? So we can have a group of drugs which can block only beta 1, or we can have a group of drugs which can block both beta 1 and beta 2, right? So here we'll talk about the drugs which block both beta 1 and beta 2. So that is beta 1 and beta 2 antagonist, right? So that includes a drug called propranolol. That is a drug called propranolol. Now we should understand what happens when I use propranolol in a person. The contractility, conductivity of the heart is decreased. Well, I have a patient with heart condition in which I had to use adrenoblocker, that is beta adrenoblocker. For example, I used propranolol. So propranolol will block both of beta 1 and beta 2. So beta 2 is also located in the bronchus, right? What happens to bronchus? If beta receptor of the bronchus is blocked, the bronchus will start to contract, right? So now we should be very careful. It will cause bronchoconstriction, and this is contraindicated in asthma, right? So I will discuss the generalized uses of these beta adrenoblockers once again in this video, but I want to tell a key point, that is they are contraindicated in the asthma, right? And one more thing, this is also called as prototype drug. Propranolol is also called as prototype drug. Prototype drug. So now we have other group of drugs, that is which blocks only beta 1 adrenoreceptors, right? So what happens when I block only beta 1 adrenoreceptors? Heart rate will go down, right? Conductivity of the heart is decreased. So now let's name the drugs which are beta 1 selective blockers, right? We have some drugs such as atenolol, we have some another drug called as acebutolol, we have celiprolol, we have esmolol. So all beta blockers ends with lols, right? We have one more drug called as metoprolol. Right? Among all these group of drugs, one drug is, that is esmolol, it is a short acting drug. It is a short acting drug. Right? So we have many other drugs which ends with lol. These are the minimum drugs which we should know, I believe that. So we know the drugs, one is non-selective beta 1 and beta 2 blocker, that is propranolol, while as beta 1 selective blocker, that is atenolol, acebutolol, celiprolol, esmolol and metoprolol, right? So we should know the uses where we can use those drugs, right? So let's start thinking about the uses. So where we can use them? So first thing, we should understand all beta 1 blocker drugs are also called as cardioselective drugs, right? Cardioselective. So where we can use these drugs? We can use only in the cardiology conditions. So let's start with the drugs where we can use them. Well, we can use them in tachycardia. Tachycardia means what? Which there is a increased heart rate, but we just don't use it for a sinus tachycardia. For example, let's take, we have a patient with tachyarrhythmias, we can use these drugs. We can use in the angina. We should always remember there is one type of angina which is called as vasospastic or Prinz metal angina. In Prinz metal angina, there is already vasoconstriction. So in that condition, the beta adrenoblockers are contraindicated. So they are used in a classic angina but contraindicated in vasospastic angina. Right. Apart from that, we can use it in the congestive heart failure, but that these drugs are never used in acute attacks of acute congestive heart failure, but they are used in a chronic congestive heart failure. Right. They are used in a chronic congestive heart failure. Apart from this, we can use in other conditions such as thyrotoxicosis. What happens in thyrotoxicosis? The patient will have severe tachycardia when there is a acute thyroid storm. We can use this group of drugs, right? So we can use it in thyrotoxicosis. Where else we can use these drugs? We can use them in hyperthyroidism, we already told. And apart from these, we can use them in the prophylaxis of the migraine. We can use them in the prophylaxis of migraine. Right. So these are the some uses of the beta adreno blockers. Right. So apart from these, we have one more group of drugs, that is non-selective alpha and beta blockers, which means which blocks both alpha receptors and beta receptors. So we have group of drug which blocks both alpha and beta blockers. So we have two drugs in this group, that is labetalol and we have one more drug, that is carvedilol. Right. So these are the drugs. Obviously, we can understand what happens when both alpha and beta receptors together block. So this labetalol, earlier it was a drug of choice for the patients, for the pregnant woman who is having hypertension. Pregnancy, hypertension. Right. So this is a story for adrenergic antagonist. Keep following, guys. Thank you.